All right, welcome back to NoHo Radio, and we're here with our guest, Jonathan London, who doesn't like Batman. And I'm Alex.
I don't hate Batman. I think that Batman is celebrated for the wrong reasons, and ultimately we have a violence-prone psychopath who thinks punching people in grease paint is a better solution than using the billions of dollars you have to fund education in the police force and the infrastructure of your city, and that is flawed. I believe that he is simply not wanting to cure Gotham so that he can continue to punch people.
Now I'm Batman, and I'm going to drive my Batmobile into you.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so right, cool. Our star for the show, Jonathan London, is here. You've heard of him. You've heard him talk. He's a celebrity status, apparently.
I'm really sorry.
No, Teddy, don't apologize.
I have to apologize to Teddy. I took Teddy talks.
Dude, that was the best Teddy talks ever.
We started talking Teddy about war dogs, talks. And I ended up going on a freaky... I don't think Teddy ever talked
about that. No, he did not talk.
Teddy, I'm so sorry.
That's fine. It's okay. You were so funny, and we're really glad to have you here on the show. Let's get this interview started.
I get excited.
Your time to talk. How about that?
Well, I don't know what's left to talk about.
This is awesome. Okay, well, so I know that you've had a podcast for like 11 years. Uh-huh. Tell us a little bit of how that amazing thing started. Like,
we're
how
interested.
This, yeah.
Well, my history of podcasting started, I think it started in high school. When middle school, high school, like I wanted to be David Letterman. I thought, or like when Greg Kinnear used to host Talk Soup. Do you guys even remember the Soup with John? Mm-hmm. Who used to do the Soup on E? The first iteration of that was with Greg Kinnear, who I think is a phenomenal actor. And I used to watch Greg Kinnear do the Soup and be like, oh yeah, you can just make fun of stuff for a living. This is fantastic. And,
perfect.
And obviously, like when like this is how old I am, but when the David Letterman Jay Leno thing happened at NBC and they didn't know who was going to take over for Johnny Carson, I was like, well, Letterman's weird and cool. I like Letterman, and that obviously leads to like Conan O'Brien and liking that stuff. And I always thought that I was going to end up going into that broadcasting area where it's like, okay, I'm gonna host stuff. And so when I went to college, I wanted to immediately go into student radio, and I did student radio for 4 years at Penn.
And what was your major?
My major was communications, because I absolutely thought that I was going to do radio. And then in telling stories on the radio, things just started getting really visual, and my parents... I remember my dad got me a Hi8 camcorder for Christmas, and I'm not one of those... And by that point, I'm already in college, so I'm not one of those kids who was like, oh, I made G.I. Joes with my friends when I was 8 years old. Because that's like the go-to on every director's bio, and...
Okay. G.I. Joes?
Well, making camcorder videos when you're a kid with G.I. Joes, it really explains why every damn movie feels the same. Because I'm like, oh, because instead of actually having life stories, you guys were running around with G.I. Joes. And I was like, and so I ended up just in college having this camcorder and shooting stories that were kind of born out of the radio show, because I had a radio show at like 10 a.m. and it was live and nobody would come and do the interviews. Like, I'd be like, hey, do you want to guest on my show? And people were like, what time is it? It's like, it's 10 a.m. on Sundays. And they're like, I'm not doing that. So, you know, so my friend Kevin and I were the only ones, and I was straight edge. So like, and I still am straight edge, but like I didn't drink or anything. So I was never hungover. And so I named the show Hungover, and we did Hungover for 4 years in college.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
But the problem is nobody would come on the show, even when like...
Because they were all hungover.
They were all hungover. and so we did Hungover for 4 years, and even though like we were only the first year doing it at 10 a.m., and then we went to noon, and then I think... And then WXPN is the public radio station in Philly, and they are a huge radio station. And because they were on campus... using a campus building, they had to give the students a show. And so they were like, okay, we'll give you guys a show. Do you guys want 10 p.m. on Sundays, or do you guys want midnight? And I was like, well, what time do you guys go to sleep? Because when you guys are asleep, we want that show, because we don't want you guys listening to what we're going to do. And so we ended up doing a show on midnights at 88.5 FM in Philly. And what I didn't appreciate at the time was that 88.5 in Philly goes almost to freaking New York City.
Oh, wow.
And it goes almost to like... Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Oh, it goes almost all the way to like the bottom of, like, it almost reaches Baltimore. It's a massive public radio station.
Wow.
And we're up there, my friend Kevin and I, still keeping the same culture of not having anybody to interview. At that point, we didn't want to interview anybody because we were having too much fun creating fake interviews. Because I really... I wanted to be a late night talk show host. Right. So I would so be like cute. In the studio now, and we'd just make voices. And these characters were ridiculous.
Wow.
And so we started doing this on 88.5 between playing like bad punk songs, and we started having bands in the studio record songs and stuff. Like, we really tried to use the resources, and people would start calling and be like, "Hey, I'm driving up from I'm driving up from Baltimore. I just started listening to you guys, and that person you just had on the air was crazy. Is he like? Can I talk to him?" And it was me doing the voice. so I'd be like, "Yeah, hold on, let me go get him." And then I'd like shuffle CDs to be like make it seem like I was moving, and I'd be like,
"Sound effects."
And then I would come back and be like, "Yeah, what's up?" And so we got bored with just the fake interviews, so we started like being like, what if we do stories with these characters? And then ultimately that led to us shooting like short films and things. And wow. So I went to film school, and that led to going into directing. But as far as filmmaking goes, like that was all, it was still always my goal when I moved to LA. It was always my goal to still kind of do some kind of broadcasting, right? And podcasting just seemed like the best thing. And at the time, I think this is 2005, podcasting and things like Dig Nation were starting out. My friend Dan was like, "Do you want to start a podcast with me where we just talk about movies and comics and video games and stuff?" And I was like, "We're going to talk about that stuff anyway. Might as well put it on the air." And I remember episode 13, we'd just been talking about Clerks 2, which hadn't come out yet. And I misquoted Kevin Smith in an interview he did with Wizard Magazine. Uh-uh. And I got an email in my inbox that was like, "Hey, Jonathan, it's Kevin Smith. And I don't think I ever said those things. And I'd like to come on your podcast and talk to you." And he had never, and he was still touring colleges and not podcasting and stuff. And I wrote back, "F you, you're not Kevin Smith." Because
you told him
I was like, "What are you talking about? You're Kevin Smith. Kevin Smith does not listen to my stupid podcast that I've only done 12 episodes of."
Right.
There's no way
right.
Kevin Smith listened to my podcast on episode 12. And what he did was he went to his website where he can obviously log in as himself and create a forum as himself. And he created a forum. And all the forum did, remember forums? All he did was create a forum that said, in the title of the forum was, "Hi, Jonathan, it's me, Kevin. When can I come on your show?" And he sent me the link to it. And I clicked on it. And I was like, oh, my God.
It really is him.
And so he came on episode 13. And that got us like an influx of listeners.
Wow. That's
and
awesome.
Then that show ended after a year. And I was like, okay, well, let's keep this thing going. My co-host and I we didn't want to do a show together. And it's fine. Because that led to me doing Geekscape, which I had control of. Like, nobody can walk out and be like, "Geekscape's dead," because it's mine. Does that make sense? So I was like, okay, well, let's just keep podcasting and keep doing this. Because I just thought that I had built a community at that point, and that was all I had as a director and a storyteller. Like, nobody was hiring me to do anything as a filmmaker. And I couldn't get arrested. And so it was on me to create an audience and then use that audience to like maybe pull some kind of attention for myself mm-hmm. as a filmmaker. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a little bit of both. I think having an audience has been great, and people look at you as a way to promote their projects, and in that way I can mm-hmm. network. So I've met a lot of TV showrunners. Like, I've met a ton of celebrities, and I did the show out of my house for so many years. We do it out of a studio now, but it's crazy when like your neighbor comes and I was like, "Simon Pegg at your house?" And I was like, "Yeah." And so we just moved to the studio.
I actually have a question for you. You said it's interesting. You said that you always wanted to be a television show host, and you ended up broadcasting, but you went to school for film. Is it, you know, how do you feel about not getting work as or in the film or the storytelling world and being more into the broadcasting? How does that make you feel?
Well, at times the podcasting just isn't enough. Does that make sense? Or you know what it is? It's, I love doing this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But it doesn't satisfy, it doesn't scratch every itch. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? There's still stories in me that have to get out. And in order to do that, I had to write.
Yes.
And that's something I didn't appreciate early on. I was like, oh, I'm going to get there through podcasting. No, the only thing you're going to get through podcasting is more podcasting, which mm-hmm. is fine. And I do love it. But this past week on the podcast, I did tell my audience, "Hey, guys, I got a fellowship in Vermont for screenwriting. I have to go and do this show, or go and do this fellowship, which is a nice, prestigious fellowship. I have to go do it for a week." We're going to have a sub, by the way, Carlos. No, because I'm also teaching. But I made the conscious decision five years ago, after doing Geekscape for about 5-6 years, I made the conscious decision, okay, Jonathan, the podcast is going great. The website's going great. The community that you've built is going great. At that point, I now had a booth at Comic-Con. We're building this thing.
That's cool.
It's awesome. And but the filmmaking was getting ignored. The storytelling was getting ignored. Mm-hmm. And I still had that stuff inside of me. I did two shows at Fox, which are fun, but they never got off the ground. Mm-hmm. They were on Hulu. And it's like, congratulations, you're on Hulu. And it's cool, but it was never good enough.
Right?
Like, I'm pretty driven. Obviously. So I said, okay, what's the problem here? And that's what led to teaching was the problem was I wasn't writing. Mm-hmm. The nascency of all of this is writing. The most nascent form of all of this is that you have a story. Mm-hmm. And I was ignoring it because I was like, well, I'll just talk about other people's stuff. Mm-hmm. You can talk about other people's stuff all you want, but if there's a story inside of you, mm-hmm. it has to come first. Mm-hmm. So I've kind of, at this day, 2016, I've told myself, okay, Jonathan, you can do your podcast for an hour. And Derek Cranavolt's my managing editor on the website, and I just want to kiss his feet all the time because he loves it. And I can only really podcast for an hour a week because the rest of the time I really have to be telling my stories. Mm. And so in about 2009, 2010, I told myself I'm going to start teaching. I'm going to quit chasing music videos and commercials, which was how I was paying the rent then. I had had the two shows at Fox fizzle out, which was how I was also paying the rent. And I said, okay, dude, like, let's pay the rent. Let's direct when you can. And let's definitely have that income from just teaching. But what that'll do is free you up to write scripts, mm-hmm. which is something that I just ignored at my own professional detriment for so long. Being like, I'll direct other people's projects. If you direct other people's scripts, great. But you're also telling their story.
Mm-hmm. Not your own.
If you have mm-hmm. a story to tell, mm-hmm. even if you hate writing, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. You're going to at least have to write an outline or a first draft of it. Yeah. And here's the problem with me. I love talking. I love people. I love the connection of seeing you guys. Hi, Teddy. I have such a passion for finding out other people's stories. Writing is lonely. Mm. Writing is doubt. Writing is rewriting. Writing is tearing up everything that you just did and trying to make it better. And it is a game of inches. Mm-hmm. So doing the podcast and having people wanting to like have me host things and make things and stuff... That was fast, and that was fun, and it was exciting. But there was still very much that voice inside of me that was like, but what about these stories who you are? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And you know speaking of like that inner story, you know, now in your experience as a teacher, mm-hmm. you know, how do you make sure that the students kind of like express that inner voice that they all have? You know, they all have this individuality
Let's get me fired. Let's do
how
this.
How do they reflect that in your work?
Let's do this because, I love, you know, AI, I love you guys. And obviously I teach here.
Disclaimer.
But I find myself conflicted. And I think any student who's had me will... And I don't want to toot my own horn and be like, oh, the teacher's so different. But my secondary job is to teach. I've always said this, and I've thought about this, but I think my secondary job here is to actually teach you guys facts. Mm. And I'm sorry, but there's books, there's tests, there's quizzes, there's facts. Okay, someone else wrote those things. But the tree you will grow into
is your own.
Is the acorn, right? Mm-hmm. And I want to find that. Mm-hmm. For me to do that, I have to question you, mm-hmm. and I have to talk, and I have to challenge you, and I have to ask you why. I can give you so many what, when, where, and hows. I need you to meet me with the why. Because when that voice starts up, that's the fire that needs to get lit. Mm-hmm. And if I spend all 4 hours of class not teaching you how to set up a freaking C-stand, but I teach you how to question why you wrote what you wrote and what and why it was born in something that happened to you 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, mm-hmm. then I've got you down the road of singing your own song. I've got you down the road of, like, telling your own story. Mm-hmm. And that is the cool thing about Geekscape is that I get to talk to people. And I challenge myself to have a guest every week because we do a show every week. And I get to just talk to them and be like, why do you tell stories? Like, where is that born from? You know? Yeah, and then in myself, what's crazy is my screenwriting career's starting to do better, and it's only doing, it's not doing, being done better. It's not doing better because I'm writing superhero scripts, or I'm writing fantasy scripts, or I'm writing sci-fi scripts, or the things that everyone expected me to write because I was doing a freaking show called Geekscape, and that my Wikipedia says host of Geekscape. My career is doing better because I'm writing scripts about who I am and what, and it's like, I didn't think anybody wanted those freaking stories. And you look at the multiplex, and it doesn't look like anybody wants those stories. You know what I mean? Like, but at the end of the day, like the super, like we're gonna go back to superhero stories, Teddy. But it's like the stories are important because they're about people.
Yeah.
And if extraordinary things happen, then extraordinary things happen. But at the end of the day, like we watched Star Wars because Luke was stuck on a farm and he hated it and he wanted to be anywhere but there. And that's been us many times in our lives when we're at work, at school. I've seen it in my students' eyes. You know, we're in our hometown. We're all these places we don't want to be and we aspire to be on these great places. And that's why Star Wars worked. It wasn't because there were a bunch of laser swords and a freaking Wookiee running around. That is not why Star Wars worked. Star Wars worked because it was a character who we could relate to on a core level. And it could have been a drama. It could have been a war movie. It could have been all those things. And it was. And the fantastical stuff is just ornaments on a very clean Christmas tree that resonated with all of us. Show me in the prequels where that character was. You can't. Mm-hmm. And that's why those movies are flawed. And that's why those movies don't really resonate beyond selling a crap ton of toys. We need to know who that character was. We need to see ourselves in that character. Mm-hmm. There's not even a main character of that series.
Mm-hmm. And I think it also talks about putting yourself fully into the project that you're working on. Because a few shows before, we had Drew Waters here, our Dean of Academic Affairs, and he was talking about the importance of really putting like your self into the creative work that you're experiencing. So it's like, it's not the same to say, oh, okay, I'm just making this music because it sounds cool, and saying, well, like you're saying, why are you making this? What does that mean to you? I'm putting yourself really fully into the project, and then that only yields, you know, a creative work that's much more meaningful. And
it's
people can tell.
And it's scary. The script I wrote, Commitment, that got me this fellowship and that is currently going through like the awards process, a couple festivals, is it was absolutely about the fact that when I was 17 years old, my brother was killed by a drunk driver. It's absolutely about my anger. You just heard me go crazy and have fun talking about superheroes, but
you're angry.
I think I'm curious about this stuff because I think every stone needs to be turned over.
True.
You know what I mean? Like every stone needs to be turned over, and I found myself in complete denial because I was the funny guy who podcasted and did stand-up and did all this fun stuff. Mm-hmm. I was the party guy about what the heck's inside of me and like why I'm maybe deflecting with this humor. And so I was like, I'm going to explore this in a script. And it was painful and it was scary and it had repercussions in my life that I'm probably still going to feel. And I'm like, oh, but it's cool to see that people are responding to it. And the next one is also about that. And like I told you that like the only superhero script that I want to write is the one that I'm writing now. And it's about the butler of the super team because it's like I think Alfred is the most fascinating character of the Batman universe because he's a guy who was like, oh, here's the solution to an 8-year-old billionaire losing his parents. Let's turn him into the world's greatest ninja. It's like, what? I think it's fascinating. I'm like, why did he think that that was a solution to anything? And then when all of a sudden Batman looks up and has a Robin, why is he going to allow that to happen again? And so I'm not saying that that's a movie about like child endangerment or child abuse or bad parenting. I think it's a movie about a character. I think it's a story about a character who doesn't have all the answers, yet has to support and has to be a rock to an 8-year-old kid, and it's awesome because he's flawed.
I agree with both of you, bro, especially when it comes to music, because I said if you put whatever you feel or if you put it into it, it resonates, and that's what sells.
Yeah.
You know, your personal story, your individualized story is what sells, and that worked for you too, right, Jonathan?
Well, seller, I don't know. I think all sorts of garbage sells. You know what I mean? Like, I think it's like, I don't think it's what sells. I think it's what sticks.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Because they can relate to it.
Yes.
Someone can relate to it, so they'll be more likely to buy it.
Yeah, no, I mean, obviously I was disappointed. I'm always looking at these movies that I love so much.
Yeah.
Like, I'm always looking at them to have more, right? Mm-hmm. And I went to, like, the IMAX experience, something or another, to see Suicide Squad, and I'm married, so I got two tickets.
You're so disappointed on that movie.
but here's the thing, like, we've all felt like we're rejects, and we've all felt like there's no place in society for us.
Yeah.
Yet there's always been this part inside of us that needs a kinship with other rejects in order to create a greater meaning and a greater bond.
Of rejects.
I think to give us purpose.
Yeah, of course.
Right? And like,
I mean, that's great.
And that's Suicide Squad.
Yeah, exactly.
Make that movie. Instead, it's like, yo, the soundtrack's going to be tight. And there's going to be effects. And there's going to be we're going to put Harley Quinn in it. And it's going to, she's going to look
Harley.
And it's cool. But like,
Mr. J.
but it's like, do you even understand that Harley Quinn is, like, Harley Quinn is an interesting character.
Yeah.
Because you can tell so many things through her.
Daddy issues.
Not just daddy issues, but is she a powerful enough woman to understand that she's in this abusive relationship, in this codependent relationship, and it's like, and now she's in this relationship with other rejects, and like, her place in the team is interesting, and how does that dynamic work? And it's like, no, we're just gonna throw you a bunch of special effects and fluff in one-liners. And it's like, and I'm just saying, guys, let's work harder to do important things, and
like
when you
that.
Do that, you're not going to have a 79% freaking drop off the second weekend at the box office, because people are going to walk out of your Suicide Squad movie and be like, you know what, that movie kind of said a little something about me, and I'm going to go tell my friends to see it, and then word of mouth is going to carry that thing. Guess what movie I just described? Guardians of the Galaxy. And it was up until a Hunger Games movie came out and American Sniper, both of which came out at the tail end of the year and made a lot of their money in the following year. 2015 was the number one year at the box office in a movie that, in a year that Captain America, the Winter Soldier came out in. Guardians of the Galaxy worked because it was roughly what I just described to you.
Exactly.
A bunch of disparate people alone in the dark looking to connect. Sounds like a movie theater going audience. But it also sounds like that story. And it also sounds like us not like going through life, right? And not understanding our place and just wanting to make connections. Not again, unlike why I got into this in the first place, storytelling and the strength of it.
Yeah.
It's all character. DC, please, we're going to need you to
rethink your
DC.
It's okay, guys. Guys, I will go to opening night of any reboot that you guys want to do, but I think let's rip the Band-Aid off and realize that the path is not worth continuing down.
Well, if DC remakes Mortal Kombat, we'll have a hit.
Mortal Kombat! my buddy Kevin Tancharo was supposed to... He did the series for Machinima, and he was signed on to do the Mortal Kombat movie, but Kevin does such an awesome job at doing those... He directs, like, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and, like, a bunch of shows for, like, CW, and he does all those superhero movies for, like, all those superhero shows of Berlanti, and I'm just waiting for him to, like, do it, because Kevin understands that stuff. He gets it really well, and we geek out. We were both in Vancouver on CW shows last September or October, and we're the same age. And what you learn in TV is that, like, a lot of the directors are, like, older dudes in their 50s and 60s, right? So Kevin and I are sitting there, and we're like, oh, dude, the Iron Giant's having a special screening this weekend. Let's go. And we would just go to the movies and talk about these characters, and... And I think that's, and I was thinking about him, and I wanted to ask him, like, dude, what does Mortal Kombat mean to you? Because Mortal Kombat's one of those franchises that if somebody was like, hey, dude, do you want to do a Mortal Kombat movie? I'm like, I don't really get it. But if I'm going to do a martial arts movie, I want to do Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, because it'll say something about brotherhood, and it'll say something about fatherhood, and it'll also say something about, it'll say something. And I don't think, obviously, that's not what's happening right now in the current iteration of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles stuff, but it's inherent. And Kevin Eastman's been a guest on Geekscape, but I think that's what's inherent to why those characters resonate. And if you continue to not satisfy that core characteristic, you are going to erode the franchise down to the point where you're not making money anymore. So it's listen, guys, Hollywood, it is commercially in your best interests.
Yeah, to do meaningful
to
work.
To do
with
meaningful
content.
Work with these blockbuster franchises. There's a reason that these characters have existed for 50, 80 years. They're time tested. Understand them at their core. do the work of asking why, which is the challenge I give my students, mm-hmm. and do it right. And then you'll sell all the toys and make all the money. Yay! I love money!
And then
Oh my god.
Sorry,
Teddy.
I'm not
going to
put a microphone.
I get excited. Because I love toys, dude. My office is covered in them.
Yeah. And then also, Jonathan, so aside from like meaningful work, I know that the other day I was working at the fourth floor and I saw you had your students there and you had them filming a little scene where they had to run like over and over again. And I asked you, you know, what are you guys doing? And you said they really need to understand
how
much it takes to film this.
It's
like they need to understand hands-on what this process is, because it's not the same to say, oh yeah, this is a cool movie, whatever. No, do the work yourself and then see how long it takes to produce something.
Yeah, let's not talk about movies, let's make movies, you know what I mean? Let's not talk about other people's stories, let's tell our stories, dude. I'm gonna make you guys all bummed out. My brother got 19 years on this planet. That sucks. Mm. You know, people, for the most part, you live healthy and you hang out and you're good to go and you treat other people good. You get 60 to 80 years on this planet. Mm. My grandfather in Guadalajara got 103, right? Like, you don't know how long you're going to be here, right? It's hard. Don't just talk about other people's stuff. Mm-hmm. This whole internet culture and the TMZ and this and that, the noise is just talking about other people's stuff.
Right.
Okay, so when you're looking back on your life, like, what did you do? Mm-hmm. What story did you tell? How did you resonate? And that is really hard to do because it's so...
Yeah, people thrive on drama.
Anybody can talk about someone else's stuff, and anybody can keep a diary, or any guy who knows how to play guitar to impress girls can be a better musician. Mm-hmm. Putting your stuff out there is so scary. Mm-hmm. Writing the script, I had to tell people about my marriage. I had to tell people about my fear. I had to tell people about the fact that, like, even though I'm the funny guy who loves the comics, I have this core anger issue, right? Mm-hmm. Bruce Banner style. I have, like, you know what I mean? Like, and that's so, like, makes me so vulnerable. But at the end of the day, if you want to take those things from a story that's in your head to something that you can share, you're going to have to film it, record it, create it, rewrite it, share it. And it's scary, but it's also, what you're saying, a lot of work. And my students need to appreciate it. It takes time to do it right. It takes a lot of time.
I really thought it was very interesting, Stella. You said they need to understand how long it takes to have a scene like this. You know,
I also
like
don't
the
want them
value of the work.
Yeah. I also don't want them being like, oh, class on Monday, let's shoot it on Sunday, because that's a huge mistake. Yeah. Because it takes time.
Yeah, and they had to run like 500 times. I was like, what's going
on?
And you kept apologizing to me. Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
He was like, sorry, I'm sorry.
It sounded like a herd of elephants. You know what I mean?
What class did you teach? Gym?
That was
weight
like,
training?
What was that? I think that was like, that was cardio.
That's what it sounded like.
One-on-one.
I think that was just like the first class, intro to video production.
Yeah. Okay, perfect.
It's like, if you want to do this, we're not going to talk about it. We're going to do it.
So you'll see me soon.
Yeah, let's do it. No, sign you right up. It's tough, man. The investment in this stuff, it pulls you on a physical and emotional level, a mental level. True. But you know what? What else are you going to do with your 80 years?
True.
Sit around and talk? Mm-hmm. We're doing it right now.
Also, I was wondering, like, how much do you encourage your students to branch out from what they're doing? So, for example, if it's a film student, how much do you encourage, hey, you know, maybe going to audio, going to photography, going to other things, like, you know, branch out from your major and see what's out there? Yeah. Do you think that's something important as part of their career?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I would love to hear that too, because I consider myself a digital mixed media artist. I come into the school in cinema and film, but I have a background in audio production and Photoshop and videography and photography, and I want to do it all.
Well, that's cool.
No, excuse me, I'm going to do
that's
it
cool.
all.
I'm not very technically adept. I'm someone who just thinks about story and character in visuals and how you can represent those things visually and audibly. Mm-hmm. My DP will always bring me his art and his visual abilities and enhance what we're doing together.
Right.
So, like, I would like to not have a career in which it was like a Jonathan London film, because I think it's insincere. I think that a lot of people helped make that movie. And I just kind of told them, oh, I like that color of purple. You know what I mean? And I, that sounds cool. Right. But it's such a collaborative effort.
Right. Yeah, that's what
I'm saying.
Because I know a lot of times it's important to make sure that you have a focal point.
So yes.
For instance, me, I you know, I have a patent for virtual reality music videos. So not only am I going into audio, that's important to me, but now I'm going into the visual part and the technology, so it's hard to find my place because a lot of people are like, well, you need to do this first. You need to do this.
No,
first.
Don't listen to anybody. Don't listen to anybody. Listen
to yourself. Only your teacher, yeah. Jonathan.
No, don't even. You know what? And I'm going to get fired.
Sorry, you can help me.
Don't even listen to me. I'm just telling you guys I'm telling you guys to challenge everything.
Yeah.
Like, question everything. Yes, I have to give you a grade.
Yeah.
But I'm giving you a grade based on whether or not you did the work.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, if you prove to me that you put the thought in and the effort, you thought about it, mm-hmm. you created it, you get the grade. Mm-hmm. And don't be lazy. And the question about specialization mm-hmm. is we're finding ourselves like, in the blockbuster culture or the pop hit culture mm-hmm. Of music, that we're looking at this idea that we're just telling stories at this point about other people's stories, and we become culturally inbred. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a huge danger. I think, like I said earlier with Stan Lee and George Romero, it's like you have to have an appreciation of the classics. And I challenge most filmmakers, like including myself, which I don't do nearly enough of.
Mm-hmm.
Like, go to a museum and look at some paintings. Right. Listen to some music that is not in your wheel well.
But how do you do simultaneously? You know, keep the classics in mind, but then tell your own story.
Because you start there. Mm-hmm. You start there. You know, you start with it, mm-hmm. and you understand it.
I agree with that, actually.
And if your film knowledge only goes back 20 years,
yeah.
you're only going to be... It's like you're only writing words with the first five letters of the alphabet.
Heard.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sure, you can write a couple words, but you'll never make a Shakespeare soliloquy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you may be capable of that. And you chose not to because you were lazy.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you weren't passionate. Mm-hmm. And passion's great. But I read a quote. I can't even say who it is because I forgot it. Who it was. But it's like inspirations
mm-hmm.
for lazy people.
Mm-hmm.
I'm only going to write because I'm inspired. Did your parents only go to work when they were inspired to go to work?
Yeah.
No, they went to work every freaking day.
Mm-hmm.
I have to write every freaking day. Mm-hmm. I have to sit down and force myself to do some really bad writing mm-hmm. that I am capable of in the horrors of my inabilities and doubts in order to get to those places that are true,
mm-hmm.
right? But what helps me is that I've read other things mm-hmm. and I've seen other things mm-hmm. and I've experienced life, and I want to continue experiencing these things and be adventurous and take huge risks. And I was talking to a friend today about, you know, movies that were not three-act structure films and how I thought it was exciting that you could make a movie like Boyhood and I love Richard Linklater and stuff. I was like, oh, that's completely plot-proof. But then you can turn around and write a three-act structure movie properly. I thought Captain America Civil War was freaking awesome because how the hell did that movie work? It had so many characters and it had like, yeah, roughly a three-act structure, but Baron Zemo's not in the movie for a lot, like, forcing the issue. It's just it's a pretty damn amazingly well-made superhero movie
mm-hmm.
when I thought everything had already been done,
mm-hmm.
you know? And I love that people continue to surprise themselves. I mean, I think movies like Boyhood and Birdman and all that stuff are incredible mm-hmm. because it's like, we're just going to make something unique. And we're going to take from painting, and we're going to take from song, and we're going to take from all these different cultures, and we're going to take from technology. You just want to take from all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm.
Specialize, just...
Throw it out the window?
No. No. I think just... Because if I say follow your passion, then sure. It's just go down the road, and follow the road, and be focused on that road. But you have to look at the landscape, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to appreciate what you are and look in the rearview mirror and just be aware. And I don't know, man. I just want my students to question everything, and I want my students to question themselves more than anything. And I want them to be like, What makes me tick?
I can't wait to get to your class. You're going to hate me. I question everything.
Fine. Everything.
Yeah,
everything.
No, it's fine. What? Just, you know what? Like, just do your homework.
Yeah. As long as
you make, show up, right?
Show up. That part.
At least that's a big part
of it. Yeah, show up and do your homework, and I think we're going to be fine. Like, yeah, I don't know if I'm an easy teacher or not. I think I am.
Yeah.
Is he, Carlos?
I think I am.
Carlos
over here, vice president, is your student.
Because I'm
yeah.
really conflicted. Like, I'm really conflicted with having to grade people on, I have to grade them just on effort and on what they've proven to do. Because if I grade them on who they are, that is not my job.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Who they are should be celebrated. Mm-hmm. Who they are should be like sung to the hills, and they should learn to do that for themselves.
Yeah,
you know. True. And I think that's my job number one.
Damn, that's the embracing creativity.
It's hard.
And
man.
I think what you're saying applies to every major too. Because for example, graphic design. I agree with you. I've studied like art history extensively. You know, starting from cave paintings to contemporary art. Because I feel like you need to study what. You know, other people have faced, you know, how they treated fortune angles or how they treated perspective, you know, how they solved these problems that you're going to face. Mm-hmm. And then once you have studied everything they've done, like you're saying, it's not like you're going to copy it, but I think it's a good thing to understand what they've been through.
Right. And that's why I have, you know, a conflict that because, you know, not only now am I dealing with music, but now I have to do that with film and I have to do that with technology. That's a lot. You see?
It is a lot.
Because I'm combining three elements that normally people take.
But what
one
do you need?
All three.
What do you... But what of all of it?
Because...
How much of all of it do you actually need to pull the things that are inside of you out?
Well, I mean, to
story, do that personal excavation.
To storytell in a new platform, virtual reality, that's...
How many stories are you going to tell?
I mean, endless.
How many stories are you going to tell?
Endless.
You're going to tell...
I love endless. The re-question.
Ultimately, I was like, how many stories are you going to tell? You're going to tell yours.
Well,
you're not going to tell hers. You're not going to tell his. You're not going to tell mine. Right. You're going to tell yours.
Well, if I have to do music videos for other artists, then I'm
going to
tell
You're
them.
Going to tell...
Mine?
Yours.
Okay.
And you're going to tell your version of
have
that song. I love music videos. I think I'm shooting a music video in 2 weeks. I love it. And I'm paying for it because the music video industry is dead. But I to do it because I want to give to the artist and be like, hey guys, you got me through high school. 20 years. It's like, I've been...
You said you think the music video industry is dead?
Yeah, oh yeah, because you guys
here.
Downloaded
I'm
going to
wake it back up.
You can't. You can't because the record labels don't have any money.
Well,
and so it's like...
They don't
like,
have to pay me. I'm going to do it anyway.
And so... Because people just download and it's freaking lame. But...
I'm going to talk.
I just remember shooting a music video and like... The next time I shot a music video of that band, they were like, isn't there a budget for this video? What our wardrobe budget was for our last video? And I was just like, I'll be eating by myself over
my
here.
Goodness.
And I just saw the, like, in 2005, 2006, 2007, like, the bricks just came out of the foundation. I was horrified. It was so sad. And ultimately, it did lead to teaching because that was how I was like, I'm going to pay rent doing this. I don't know, man. Like, you're going to tell your story because you're going to point a camera at one direction.
Yeah.
Someone else does that music video, they're going to point it in a totally
different
direction.
Direction.
So you're going to tell your story.
I appreciate that.
I demand it. I demand it.
Perfect.
I demand it. Like, the life demands it.
Yeah.
You demand it.
Yeah.
You should demand it.
Yeah.
You should put hooks into yourself and rip it out and equip yourself with the tools and the knowledge and the understanding of other things that will help you yank that stuff out.
Inspirational quotes from John.
Get meat hooks, put them in your chest, and rip them out. Is that what you're saying?
And I think as a result of that, you get work that's very unique. Because you're not following someone else, you're not doing what somebody else is doing, but when you really dig inside yourself, you are unique, you know, in a certain way. So it's like your work is going to have that imprint
reflection
of your personality.
You.
Yeah,
exactly.
Which is going to make it unique.
It'll keep you up at night. I know I'm on the right path because I sleep less. And that's just the truth. It's like I know that I'm pursuing something meaningful because...
You sleep less?
I just don't want to sleep. I want to do this. You know what I mean? Like, I want to do that.
I got to ask you, John, since first off, sorry about the loss of your brother, but...
Oh, yeah. Well, sorry about Teddy Talks.
I'm sorry for you saying sorry to me.
Sorry about derailing your segments.
But do you think the death of your brother has inspired you to become even more better in what you're doing now? And like, what do you think the highest point of your life is? Like, is it doing where you are right now, like teaching, yes. having your own podcast, and you know, writing your own scripts, or do you see yourself like doing even more?
And doing
like,
music what's your videos.
I love, and doing music videos. Tell you, I think, yes, absolutely. That's at the core of a lot, but. But as far as like a high point, no, because like if I reach it, then I'm no longer hungry.
Right. Exactly. So you want to keep getting better.
Oh, I freak the heck out because I'm so hungry, and I wake up, and I, you know, and it's like I freak out. I wake up in the middle of the night. And I do like I like yell. I'm like ah, and it's because I'm hungry for more, and mm-hmm. and whether or not that's me running from my own lack of permanence. Sure, but it's also like I'm possessed by these stories. I'm possessed by exploring these things inside of me and exercising them, and I have to try and exercise them to the best of my abilities. I can't do them on my own. I'm going to need a crew. I'm going to need actors. I'm going to need support. Mm-hmm. And I love evoking too, because what we're talking about here is kind of emoting.
Yeah.
But your job is also to evoke, because yeah. ultimately you want to make the connection. And mm-hmm. I know that I cannot be in control of everything, nor should I. Right? Like I don't think I should be in control of everything. I think that what I do, what is best in this medium that combines sound and imagery mm-hmm. and all these different mediums. Is why I love film so much, because it's not just still photo, it's not just sound, it's not just all this stuff, it's all of them. What I love about it is that you have to be collaborative, so like,
yes.
my story will get collaborations. Better.
Yeah, yeah, we always yeah. talk about
my story will get better. My story will get better because that actor made a choice I didn't foresee.
Yeah.
My story will get better because that person saw something in it visually that I did not foresee. Someone, and it's like that collaboration is huge, and if you compromise, if you're able to let go of yourself enough to bring those other voices in,
mm-hmm.
when you ultimately put that thing in front of an audience, they will see themselves in your work, mm-hmm. right? Like,
that's awesome.
Here's the thing. It's like, what is your favorite song? You didn't just think of the entire song. You thought of the specific lyric. What's your favorite movie? You didn't just think of the entire movie. You thought of the specific scene, mm-hmm. right? You thought of a specific yeah, moment. And
it takes a lot of people to write a song.
All you need is... all you need is that specific thing that is honest.
Mm.
And if you grow everything from there, you have a chance to make a connection and be a really good storyteller. So don't always think about the entirety of the structure. Don't always think about the tree. Think about, we're going back to the acorn.
Mm-hmm.
Think about that little thing that was nascent within you, or that first thing you planted, and the future will come out of it. And it's not all on you. To make that future, you are going to get it watered by a lot of different people who will help you grow it. Does that make sense? So, I think when we sit down to write a script, we get freaked out because we see the last draft.
Mm.
Don't see the last draft.
See the first one.
Yeah, just see that next word. You know what I mean? Yeah. Just see that next word. Perfect. And I do it all the time. I freak myself out because I'm like, oh, I'll never get to 100 pages. I'll never get to 90 pages. But if I just write that next word. That's something that I'm going to get notes on from other people who see something in it, and I'm going to rewrite it. And you know what I mean? I just can't stay in place. Mm-hmm. If you stay in place, you're done. Yeah.
So be curious. Always keep that curiosity on.
Yeah. Question everything.
Question everything. But question yourself. Like, question yourself.
Of course, you
question
to.
Yourself.
Stay hungry.
And I love hungry. It.
I don't know, man. That's just what yes. I think. It could be a
yeah. good advice.
Well, you know,
I don't know.
That's good advice.
It could be insane. I really like that you brought up collaboration, you know, as Teddy was saying, because we always talk about that here. And I say that, you know, if the radio club does what it does, it's because collaboration. Like, we have film crew, audio crew, like, everybody mm-hmm. who puts an input, photography and everything. I think that's what makes it great. So, yeah, thank you so much for being on the show, Jonathan.
I love you guys.
Thank you. Oh,
is there, the best.
Yeah.
It's not a horse race, Teddy.
We're going to talk about
it. It's not a horse race. I love Nicole Block, and I love Drew. It's not a horse
race. Yeah, they're so cool.
There's a gelato place near my house. The other night I was walking out of the gelato place, and I saw amazing. Drew sitting there, and I was like, hey, Drew, had a good conversation with him outside
talk about
school.
His check mark.
We'll show you Drew Waters' show. It was so funny. Drew's awesome. Oh, my God. He was hilarious. And then during the break, he just started playing. Like, he took out a guitar. He plugged it in. It was so funny. He's really funny guy. But, yeah, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Of course.